Hey, vegan cyclist. So the first time that I did this, where I did a full race and kind of did a little podcast over the top of it, it seemed to be well accepted, well received. And so this time I've got Darin with me, and we are going to be looking at and kind of talking about the Turlock Crit. And I've got the perfect guy for this, Darin, with me, because in this race, he was in the winning move, and he got brought back by his own team. So we're going to chat a little bit about that. We're going to chat about, again, kind of things that are going on in the race, a little bit about cycling. But I've got someone else here to help me kind of bounce some things off of. And he was also in this race. So how awesome is that? So Darin, why don't you say hi?
Hello.
What category are you, Darin?
As of this year, 2016, it was my first year as a Cat 1.
How long did it take you to get to Cat 1?
Last year, 2015, was a cat year for cat two for a few months. So I got my cat, I was a cat three, and then I got my cat two upgrade and, did pretty well at Cascade as a cat two and some other local races. And within a few months I got the cat one.
Right on. So, do you remember this race?
Yeah, I definitely remember this, this race. We had, a couple teammates here as opposed to some other guys didn't really have much of a team. I think A-Main, had a lot of guys as well. So, yeah, we had a lot of showings at, a lot of the, races. So,
and you're on Coretechs, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
Yep.
And they're a pretty big team, for this year. I mean, they were like, well, how would you rank them amongst
teams? I think that
teams?
we got third overall as a team in the NCNCA NorCal circuit.
When this race, this course, this section right here where we're going, it's sort of like a tailwind section. I don't know if you remember, but the crazy thing about this part was that it being tailwind, You would think that drafting, obviously in racing and cycling, drafting is a big part of why all the dynamics. But when you're going 35 miles an hour or something crazy because the tailwind, you know, you're just maxed out in your gear. Is it just me? But like in that tailwind section, that was one of the hardest sections of the race. The headwind section was not as bad if you're on the wheel, but that like that tailwind section, That was murderous.
Well, it was tough because at the end of the course where the finish line is, going into the first turn is this hard chicane that you go through and you just got to pick up speed and everyone's single filed and they're just picking it up. And so once it gets up to speed, you're already kind of feeling the effort from every lap of having to pick it up. So yeah, getting in that draft was definitely crucial. And we kind of just always just kept picking up speed and there would be guys just kind of going off the front. So if you weren't present, then you weren't in that move. And a lot of moves were going right here.
So a lot of teams before the race kind of have a race meeting, even at an amateur level like this. Most guys, they'll have a meeting, they'll say, okay, our goal is X, your job is Y, my job is Z. What was your game plan as a team going into this crit?
Well, we definitely wanted to be represented. We had enough guys out there to make sure we could cover all the moves. So for the most part, we definitely wanted to make sure that when these moves were going left and right, that we were represented. And so I was definitely trying to be active towards the front of the race and maybe not cause the as much attacks, but moreover just be present in those key moves.
Now, in this race, there were the two dominant teams were Cliff Bar, which you can see one right there in front. And they travel, man, they travel a lot. They do races all over America. They've done some of the most, you know, prestigious crits in America. And then you've got you guys, Coretechs, which I want to say each one of you guys had maybe five guys, right?
Right.
And so, as a team that has a ton of guys, are you worried about another team that's just as big as you? Like, what is your thoughts, or how do you play when Cliff Bar probably has as much firepower as you guys do?
I mean, you know who you're up against, and you just want to make sure if so-and-so goes off in a move, or if Cliff Bar is in a move, or if A-Main's in a move, that they're well-represented, that we want to at least match that. And if there was a key player that you know is going to go at the right times, that you're following him too. So, yeah, we just kind of marked the Cliff Bar and A-Main, and beyond that, you know, just trying to be represented was our main thing, and we figured it was going to come down to a breakaway, so it was either represented in the break or a sprint, one of the two.
But so what was your personal goal as a rider? I mean, when your team says what to you, go get in a break?
I definitely was looking for the hardest moves possible. I knew that whether it was Tony or Rob, that we would have to mark those hard moves or those attacks. But, you know, I was definitely looking for the hardest moves that I could get in so I could save my energy and efforts to do the best that I could when it came down to that effort, that key move that was made, that I was in it and that I could play my part in. Make sure that they didn't get away and be able to ride with those guys, because these moves are pretty hard to stay in, you know, going so fast and you know, like right here, this is a big headwind section. So if you're not up in the front or in that move, then you're working as hard almost as the guy up front. You're just, you know.
So let's talk about this. When you, most breakaways, they get established and will be successful after, say, the first half of the race. I mean, it's usually pretty rare that breakaway goes from the gun. I mean, it happens, but I would say statistically more breakaways that succeed get off after the half, or even in the later stages, like the last little few laps, because everyone's so tired. So in that first quarter of the race, like right now, when everyone is just blitzing, going so fast, I mean, are you looking for a breakaway? Are you looking for a move? And if you got into a move this early on, how much commitment do you allocate towards that? Like, do you go 100% into a move that goes lap 3? Or do you reserve a little bit because you know you'll probably get caught and you're going to need to respond?
I mean, it comes down to an individual, you know, how do you feel? We talk to each other before the race. Who's feeling what? How do you feel about this? And like you said, when it comes down to the last 20 minutes in the race, it's probably when something's going to go. But again, we want to be represented. So I can't remember particularly this day. Sometimes I'll go into it and the first 20 minutes I say, if it's not going to happen now, then I'll try to save myself for the end to get, you know, to get that sprinter in that right position. Or maybe it's the other way around where I'm, you know, 20 minutes, 25 minutes in, I'm trying as hard as I can, and if it doesn't work, then, you know, maybe that's all the effort I have to give, or maybe I'm just saving it all for the end. But out here, I was definitely just trying to go after those hard moves and make sure we were represented, and hopefully we can get the right setup, the right match of guys to work together to stay away.
So when you say represented, you're meaning like your team, your colors, needs to be represented in a breakaway or in a move, because if you are not, then the obligation to chase that move comes down on you, right? If there's a Cliff Bar and there's a J Velo and, you know, there's what's the A Main, you know, if they're all up there, their teammates don't have to chase that down. But if you haven't made that move, if you're not represented, right? That's what you're saying. Then it comes down to you guys to having to chase, which then you're burning matches that you don't necessarily have to burn. So you've got a designated sprinter here?
Yes, we do.
And what is his job? Sit on the back?
Basically, we're going to try to save him. He's not going to be making too many moves. We were really hoping it was going to come down to a sprint at the end. But we also have to play our part and make sure that we are in those moves, because a move can easily get away. So we kind of have an A and a B goal.
So when you're in a break, when you're trying to establish a breakaway, for someone who's not really ever been in this situation or maybe doesn't understand the dynamics, what's crazy is that you will let a breakaway go when it is properly represented. And when it's not, then that breakaway gets chased down. And so some guys will think, why am I always getting chased down? Why do I never get into the break? And I always see other guys make the break. And it's because they have information about racers and teams and dynamics that maybe that person doesn't have. So if I just went off solo right now, if I'd made a move, that's one, not a really threatening move, because it's going to get brought back. And it doesn't really make any sense, because there's every team, every person is going to chase that down. But when you get a good, well-represented move and you have three or four guys together and their team is they have a lot of guys in the back in the peloton, then you've got maybe 40 or 50% of the group no longer racing, right? I mean, you're no longer chasing for the win because you have that breakaway, set up. And so I think for some people, it gets a little frustrating because it's like, man, I can't make that move. I'm never the one in the winning break. But you have to know when that break is doomed from the beginning, right? So do you ever get in breaks and look around and go, ah, shit, these guys are either A, really weak, or B, this is a makeup that will not be allowed to go? Because if there's a break that went and Cliff Bar was not in it, how hard is that going to be to make that break work?
I mean, everyone out here is really motivated, and so the strongest guy, the most motivated person can go off the front, but inevitably the group is going to let you dangle out there far enough to where they don't have to expend their energy until the last second. And that's kind of the name of the game, is using the reserves or that last bit of energy you have till, for the right moments, the right times. And that can be through attacks or relying on your teammate or covering your teammate, or, everyone out here knows each other pretty well. There's a difference in fitness between everyone out here, but everyone's very motivated, and it was such a fast race that staying away, getting away, there's not much of a bike length that's going to go away, that others aren't going to try to follow, or how much can they, how many times can they keep doing that? So having a team out here is a really good race for a team,
And also understanding the history of the race. So this was the second year they ran this, and the first year that they ran this, I want to say a breakaway never got established, but it still was really difficult to, everyone was trying the whole time. And maybe I think right at the very end, someone kind of jumped off the front or something. But so knowing how the race played in the past usually can give you a good idea on how it's going to play in the future or at this race, right? I mean, do you use like past race experience at the same course, kind of the same guys? Do you sort of think about how it played out in the past and then use that for your tactics, or no?
I think it's a mix of what our team tactics are, how are you feeling, and how has this race gone down in the past? Sometimes it's just a Cat 1 race, sometimes it's a Cat 1-2 race, and that can change from year to year depending on the race. This one, like you said, it's the second year, but I think that all doors are open for any idea of how someone wants the race to be played out, so I think that any opportunity that you wanted is open. But
and this is you right here, right, with the yellow socks.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now your kit looks a little bit dirty, a little brown maybe. Is that because did you wear that kit the day before? The day before this race, we did an 80-mile road race in the pouring rain. Did you wear the same kit or was it a different kit? Or is that just how that blew?
No, they always gave me crap for my kit, but inevitably, you know, my experience with wearing white, it's hard to keep it clean. But, you know, maybe I could have washed it a little bit, like, you know, by hand or separate from other clothes. But eventually, like, it's really hard to keep the white kits clean. I think I did wear a different kit the day before, but needless to say, if I'm going into an X-race, I'm going to make sure it's washed. But I think I have the dirtiest kit out there. So,
dude, look at you and your teammate, like side by side. One just looks sparkling, bro. But I'm one to talk, man. I'm not, my kits are never sparkling. So let's talk about back-to-back races, because so this
also my kit's kind of a little see-through, so that might be a little skin versus how dirty it might be looking. Okay, so right. I'm gonna use that edge.
Good excuse. So the day before this, so this race was on Sunday. On Saturday, it was a Turlock road race, 80 miles or something like that, right? Or maybe it was 60.
I think it was about 82 miles or something.
Yeah, 80 miles.
And it was pouring.
Pouring rain, and that race was vicious, dude. I mean, that thing was just attacks constantly until the break got away. Did you make the break?
The separation? Winning break, I was there. Yeah, and it happened at the last on the last lap.
Did you do any moves in that road race before that?
I went with a couple efforts myself, but I didn't chase down too hard. You know, there was so many guys out there that I was sitting in quite a bit. I did do a little bit of work, but also, I mean, getting through all of that, I wanted to make sure that I had energy and all that for towards the end, which did land me in the winning break.
Yeah, I did the opposite. I went with every move, and I got in with the Zeke guy, the BMC development rider. And we had like maybe a 40 second gap at one point. Like we had a gap, and maybe it wasn't 40 seconds, but I was trying to impress him. So I was just like, just bend when I was taking my pulls, and I felt great that race. I mean, I was making so many moves, and the only, like, I used my entire box of matches, and the one move that I couldn't respond to, that I wasn't a part of, was the move that stuck, which was frustrating. But so when you're doing a road race, or even, it doesn't matter, two races, Saturday, Sunday, when you were doing that race on Saturday, are you at all ever thinking, hold on one second, so right here, you're drilling the front, we got Mustache Man on your wheel, and I'm following Mustache Man because he wins fucking everything. So what are you doing here right now? Do you remember?
Right now, look, we have a really good hard move going with some really strong guys. So, you know, being represented in here is good enough, but also
because there was a big group up
right
front.
So we're trying to catch up to these guys. We're motivated and we want to be represented. We want to get in that move. We want to be dialed up front. And that way the guys in the back are ready for when we do get caught. They're ready to launch off the front. And so, yeah, we got that extra firepower behind us, too.
So you saw this group up the road, and there was four or five guys. But one of those is your teammate? It looks like Tony might be in that move right now. Or maybe that's a different guy.
It could be.
So if you have a teammate up in the break, and because the Jay Velo guy was the one who it looks like he initiated that, and you stayed on his wheel, do you go with that or do you? So okay, five guys up the road.
I would say be a part of the break and help with some of the firepower up front. When there's a bunch of guys up here and we got one guy in the break, be a part of the break. Don't don't reel it back. So if you can get up into that break, you know, this is a crit, not a road race, very different tactics. But if you can get in that break and not bring everyone else, you know, I say do it.
Yeah.
I say two guys is better in the break, you know, when it's not two or three guys. When there's five or six or seven guys and it's a crit like this and you think you can bridge, go for it. I mean, the more guys up front, the better.
Yeah, I mean, if you can get to a break where you have two teammates, that's phenomenal. But so you have five guys up the road, and one of them's your teammate, and someone goes to bridge that, and you're in the opportunity, you're in a position to get on their wheel. You ride their wheel all the way to the break, even if there's guys on you. But so I'm going to hold that thought, because right there, you know, we caught the break and then they slowed down, and then you're all of a sudden off. You're like, you're countered that, right? Because your teammate was in the break, we caught it, they slowed down, and then you countered. But it looks like you're slowing down now. So are you just trying to conserve yourself, or?
Ultimately, I'm not going to get anywhere putting any more effort into this. And so for me to just be up here, I'm pretty fast. I'm feeling it. You know, I know my goal out here is to ride in front, ride in the break. I would say this is the field's not directly behind us, but they're slowly going to catch, especially when I slowed up. So I'm motivated. I'm ready to go with whatever flies off the front in anticipation of something happening, even though I'm feeling it towards the front. At least it relieves some pressure from some of the other teammates, knowing that I'm capable and able to be up here and to also hopefully be a part of anything that goes up ahead.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, it's a hard effort.
Right. So now we've got all these counterattacks coming, which they've been happening the whole race. I just have been on the back, because the last year I went with every move in the beginning and blew myself out. So I was trying to like hold back a little bit. I was trying to wait and not burn my matches. But so when you're at the front here, this is just basically how it is in a P1-2 crit, is just constant counterattacks over and over and over and over again until something gets established. But so let's go back to this five-man break hypothesis, or however that would be, not hypothesis, hypothetical situation. So you have five guys up the road. One of them is your teammate. A guy goes to bridge to that break, and you are in position to be on his wheel. Do you let that guy go and get into that break versus possibly being on his wheel and having guys be on your wheel, and then you drag everyone back up? Like, when do you make the decision to go, I'm not going to chase this. I'm going to let this one guy make his effort across the group, because they won't chase him, but they'll probably chase me, because I can't also be in the break, because now that's two Coretechs in the break. Does that make sense?
I mean, our philosophy was, like I said, to have two guys in the break, the better, you know? So ultimately, I would say no, don't chase that guy, because ultimately everyone else is going to be motivated enough to start chasing. You're going to use the least energy possible. You're going to have that edge over the next guy. So I would say no, you don't chase that, but there's a lot of hypotheticals that go into that, knowing who's chasing, how far into the race, what plans that we had set out, you know. Is this a good move to follow? Am I bringing everyone with me? Or no, I'm going to rely on the rest of the guys to chase. So that way, once we do get up there, I'm going to be present towards the front. I'm going to have the energy to make that next move. And again, we can be well represented.
So now critique this, because the clip bar has a guy in the break. There's three guys in the break right now. Coretechs and Cliff. Isn't that like the... Okay, maybe that's why I start to attack right there. But so that's it. I mean, that's a good makeup. That's a good representation in the break. Three guys, that means you're all going to work well together, because you're not, like, doing a pissing contest. And so Cliff doesn't need to chase. Coretechs doesn't need to chase. So now it's down to everyone else, right? But that cliff guard, that cliff by cliff bar guy, looked like he was possibly chasing it down, but doesn't look like he was.
I mean, if you can keep the front end rolling enough, you might get that next guy motivated enough to keep rolling, and eventually you got a legit breakaway where people are working together just to keep it rolling, and that's just from being represented. That's just from being a team, playing your team part is maybe it wasn't the goal to make that breakaway succeed, but being represented and other people motivated and you follow them, eventually, you know, you're rolling the break and it's legit.
What is your position now, or your obligation, your duty, when you have a guy up in the break? It's a three-man break. It's well represented. Where are you in this group now? Are you at the front trying to maybe mess with people's rotations to slow down a chase? Are you trying to stick on guys' wheels that might try to bridge? Or are you just in the back recovering?
Ultimately, I'm checking in with the sprinter. I'm seeing how he's doing. We know we got so-and-so up the road. We're communicating. We're talking about what we want to do next, how we want to follow through, and if we want to sit tight or you know, what's our goal here?
What is, kind of to go a little bit off topic, but what is your bike setup for a flat P-1-2 super fast crit?
I mean, personally, I had, a carbon tubular race wheel, and I had an 11, 23 cassette. There's not a ton of shifting going on in here, so, you know, you're definitely shifting every lap, but the range of a, like, some people were running 20, like 11, 28s, but me personally, I have a crit wheel and a crit cassette, so I was doing an 11, 23. So the difference between that and like a road race would be an 11.25 or a 28. So
what about wheel choice? Do you run deep dish carbons? Do you try to go aero? Do you have like an aero crit type mentality?
For this race, I just used the same wheels that I would use in a road race. It was about a 38 millimeter, carbon, race wheel, nothing, you know, crazy, nothing as deep as like a 50. So for me, that was good enough. I didn't need anything deeper than that.
Do you run skin suits in crits?
Yeah, I like to. I definitely like, I did in this race. I definitely like the skin suits for the crits as well. Yeah.
What are you, how do you build for something like this? Was this on your target races, or is this just the impromptu, hey, gonna hit this up?
Well, this was an Omnium weekend, and so, I mean, I'm a big stage racer. I like to kind of go for the overalls. I do well with that kind of like mentality. I had a sixth place yesterday. And so, I mean, I'm feeling pretty good. I know half these guys are feeling the weight from the road race the day before and then the travel. However, I'm feeling pretty good. I want to get in a move that'll play out well, and hopefully, you know, I can go for the overall. But ultimately, this was a B priority team race. And if I didn't make this race, it wouldn't, you know, I'm going for the overall. So
you weren't obligated to be here. You didn't have to be at this race. It would be cool if you were here, because then you have more guys working. But this isn't something you were targeting necessarily with your training.
Absolutely not. I'm not in like a peak, or I wasn't training hard for this particular race. I ultimately enjoy the road racing the most. So when you know, half the team is setting out to be here, they're playing there, we're holding each other accountable, we're communicating, it's kind of fun to play your part and be there for the next guy. So the team was there, I'm there, I said I'd be there originally. It was a fun weekend of racing.
How much risk do you take when you're in a crit like this? When you dive bomb turns, you're bumping bars, you're getting as close to the wheel in front of you to get the most draft. How much risk do you take? Do you think about it, or how balls to the walls do you go?
Well, this was a really fast race. We were taking corners, I think, as we're pushing the limits on these corners for sure. There's not too much gravel, a few loose rocks. It was kind of a bumpy course, more on the backside, and there was some potholes to watch out for. But I mean, hey, that kind of goes in, hand in hand with some of the roads that we're in races we're doing. But
how about right here, this turn? So what I was doing is similar to like a street, like I used to race street bikes, MotoGP type stuff. And coming into that turn, you're going probably 30 to 32 miles an hour. And then you're having to slow all the way down to about 20. Are you shifting? Like I'm shifting, like clack, clack, clack. I'm shifting way down before I hit the turn so that I'm in the right gear. So I'm not over geared coming out. But then it's hard because you don't want to be undergeared and then spin out, because if you've ever been leaned over and you go to spin and put power down and there you're not in the right gear, it just kind of like is too loose, and then you start to get the bike like gets upset and then you might crash. So how much thought are you putting into, or what's your technique when you're coming into a really sharp like 180 turn like that?
Well, I mean, in a course like this, where do you feel most comfortable? Do you feel comfortable up at the front where you are can avoid a crash, or is it every lap you're feeling better and better about it, and you're getting more comfortable, with the course the more that you do it. So, ultimately you just kind of, how comfortable are you? And I think that the more, you're confident in your skills, the faster and the more efficient that you're going to be in the racing and in the course,
For sure. So now there, your teammate, Tony Wolf, my coach, he countered a move, because you guys, it was like always a Coretechs dude off the front or on the front initiating. So it was really kind of neat to see you guys constantly counterattacking. And so I'm trying to go with those moves every once in a while, but as a guy here with no team, I cannot go with every move. But for a guy that has a team, kind of walk me through, I guess, the order, the order of who goes first.
I mean, the more you know your teammates, the more you race and ride together, the more you know each other's skills. And, so right here in the race, I had participated in quite a few efforts. Then now I'm like, well, it's up to me it's up to my teammates now. I'm going to need to recover. They're telling me to sit back, and they're telling me to recover, save some energy, so we can get Nick or Tony, Tony or Rob or Nathaniel into a break, and Nick can conserve and whatever. So we're kind of taking turns, throughout the race. And I don't mean I take one turn, he takes the next, and he takes the next. It's be represented no matter the cost. And if me and Rob are doing that in the first, third or half of the race, then Tony, no matter how he's feeling, he's going to have to be there at those times and go for those moves. Otherwise, it's we didn't play our cards very well, and we're not representing our team very well either, with the win in mind.
For sure. So I had just gone right there with some of the Cliff Bar guys, because the Cliff Bar guys are doing the same thing you guys are, basically just attacking every freaking second they get. And so I'm kind of looking at anything red, I'm following, anything blue, I'm following. But I haven't really been trying to work through some of those moves. But like you can see right here, that's Rob, right? Rob goes, and I know he's strong. And so, and I think there's a Cliff Bar guy. Look at my face. I'm just kidding. I was digging, man. I want to be in that move. Cliff Bar, Coretechs, yes. Yes, please. And so that is a move that I'm going to dump myself into. I'm going to go so in the red. I'm going to basically tell myself I'm going to do whatever I can to get in this move. But what sucks is right now, when they sort of look at each other and go, so you make this huge effort to bridge and then it doesn't really go anywhere. You know, that's frustrating because you wasted all your matches on that. I don't know if you ever had it where there's a promising break. It looks like they're working. You just literally bleed out of your face to bridge up to it. And as soon as you get to them, they all just sit up and mushroom out and are just like, nah, not working. Does that ever happen to you?
I mean, that's the luck of the draw. That's the way the breakaways work. And if you're a breakaway, you know, type of rider and you're going for it, I mean, you could get dealt a good hand or, you know, you could have shit luck. That's how the breakaways work is you kind of get lucky and hopefully everyone's willing to work together and you don't want to work harder than, you know, the next guy. But when ultimately you're chasing moves that are, you know, good, hard, you know, moves that you think that will work. I mean, at the same time, I mean, how much effort are they putting into these? Like, you're putting your heart and soul into this and these guys are just representing on the front and then soft pedaling. So it's like, you know, that's the difference between being with yourself, being by yourself, riding solo and having a team. It's, you know.
So now I think that Rob had yelled at you. You were countering and then he yelled at you. I don't know if you remember that. I think he was saying, like, don't go or something of that sort. I don't know if you have someone up in the break. But so you were trying to get two dudes in the break. And that's a hard thing to do because you don't want to bring everyone up to that move, right? But so how do you know when to shut it down or how do you know when to try to go for it? Because that's a hard thing to do, to have two of the same teammate in a break. So like, what is your etiquette on that?
You know, again, you know, having those teammates and communicating is a big thing. So, you know, Rob was really good at reading the races, and he would kind of just command me one way or another, and it would, you know, I'd play my part according to, you know, just our plan how we were communicating. Yeah, if he tells me to go, then I'm gonna go. If he tells me to hold off, then I'm gonna hold off. You know, and that was just kind of how we were communicating.
Right, and that's a good group of dudes up there. And you know, it sucks because if I just kind of similar to something like that, where now I bridged up, but then like the break splits in half right as I get to them, like three guys are dropping off.
Well, we had our sprinter in that move too. And so ultimately, I think if your sprinter's in that move, whether it's two, three, four, or five guys, you're gonna hope that he can out-sprint everyone and in that breakaway, you know, ultimately still take the win.
Yeah, for sure. If your sprinter gets into a break of four or five guys, like that's sort of game over.
But you never want to drag everyone else, reel that break in with everyone else. Otherwise, your efforts and energy is, you know, is a waste.
Right. Now, do you take a mental note of guys during the race on how many matches they've burned to know how fresh they are? Like, would you be knowing, okay, this guy right here, Alex Kabatic, like, he's super strong, he's a great sprinter, and he hasn't done any moves. He hasn't been on the front, he's been on the back. So do you put higher priority to maybe watch him? Or are you just not taking any of that into account?
You know, every race is going to play out differently. Every race. And if you're at the back of the race, you know, you know, it might be hard to see what's going on, but you're also saving the most energy. You're probably most at risk as well. But your intent is I mean, if you're hanging on to a race and you're at the back end, that's one thing.
So let's talk about this real quick. His mustache man, he goes, Rob goes, and I'm thinking, well, Cliff Bar still hasn't. Ah, fuck, Cliff Bar's going. So I have to go with that move because you've got Coretechs and Cliff Bar, which are the two dominant teams, and then you have Mustache Man.
And they're just launching it off the front. I mean, full gas, just going for it. I mean, that move could easily stick.
It should have stuck. I mean, that was a good move. And, you know, spoiler alert, it doesn't work out for me. Because of one guy, Chaz, an ex-teammate of mine, he was feeling really good. He was peaking, and he got on the front solo and just reeled us back in to the point that then guys could start to try to bridge that gap. But this was a really good move. And you've raced with Mustache Man. That guy, in his draft, I'm blowing into pieces. And then he flicks his arm, and it's like, psych, bro. Do you know what I mean? I'm pushing 450 watts in your draft. How do you work with someone who is possibly double the strength of you?
I mean, my philosophy is if you're working that hard to be up in there, you know, you could blow up being in there. And if he's flicking his elbow and you can't make that move, well, I mean, you might gain some fitness from blowing yourself up that hard in a race. So maybe it was good training for you.
Okay, but so you make this move. You bridge up to this. Mm-hmm. And I think another Cliff Bar guy does as well. That's when I thought, game over. And I figured, and Rob, your teammate, got in my face after the race about this, and we yelled at each other during the race. But he was yelling at me for not pulling through. But it's like, dude, you have two Cliff Bars and two Coretechs and Mustache Man, who is like an entire team in and himself, and then me. Don't I get a free ride? Like, wouldn't that be the most acceptable time to just be like, dude, you guys have way more firepower in here. I'll still pull through, but I could skip a pull if I wanted to because I'm way outmanned.
If you're motivated enough and you're gonna make that hard of an attack to bridge up, I mean, you didn't make the move anyway, so you're bridging up to it as it's kind of being initiated. So you're hoping it's going to keep rolling. And as we've seen in this race, those hard attacks, those bridges, I mean, those breaks, they've done nothing but just got up to the front and fanned out, and it was over. So you've noticed a trend, whether it be on purpose or not. That's just the way they've been playing out. So if I was motivated enough, then if I would have caught up to those guys, I would have rolled right past them, did my part, showed them I'm here to work. And even though those guys are just representing their team, whether they're, you know, in the right move or not, all they're doing is representing their team because they have that. So if you're there, I would roll past them to show, look, I'm here to do work too. Come with me and you know, if you're rolling past them, the break's probably going to be over soon.
Yeah. Well, so like right here, you made it. So now, again, there's two Coretechs. And you and Rob are super strong. Everyone in here was stronger than me. And so Rob was telling me, you know, I'm going to drop you off if you don't keep working, if you don't make your pulls. Which means that he will get in front of me and then slow down to separate me off of the break. And just telling me that if I'm not going to work, I shouldn't be there, which is definitely accurate, I think, if we're all equal. If there's one Coretex and one me and one Cliff, like right there, I let that dude cycle in. You know, I'm way outnumbered here. And if I want to win this race or have a chance to do really well, I'm going to have to play this super smart. And I sort of felt like I was playing this smart, but man, Rob was giving me.
Well, just that's just the leisure you have of, you know, being in a break towards the end of a race with another teammate is you're working you know, more, way more than he is. And the guy, he also has another guy up there too that, you know, if you're not showing that you're willing to work harder than him, he's going to play games to get rid of you because it's not helping us out. You know, you're going to have to always work harder than that one individual when he has a team to get in these moves.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, whether or not they have an intention of winning or not, if you work hard enough, you get towards the front, you keep the break rolling, they're not going to drop off.
See, like right here, I haven't taken a pull of maybe two laps, you know, and Rob's yelling at me right here. He's just cussing me out. And so I'm just saying, man, for one, I'm hurting. I feel like if I go to the front, if I take a pull at the pace that these guys are pulling, I'm blowing into fireworks. But also, I mean, like we've just been saying, I'm kind of using that you guys have a situation now where you're two teammates, so you guys can play some serious games. He could go off, or you go off. You know, you guys could start counterattacking. And so maybe my mistake was that I sort of started to play like the last K game. You know, like when we're getting close to the finish, you sort of try to put yourself in a good position or whatever. Maybe I was doing that way too far out. But, I mean, I just didn't feel like I had a whole lot to contribute onto the front of this thing at this point. If it had gotten established, and this is what I was trying to tell Rob, once it actually got established, then I would start making pulls. And I would go 100% full gas. But like you said, the last 15 breaks like this in this race have not worked. So I'm going to use my experience of what has happened and what you know. So I'm thinking like let's get 20 seconds on the group. Let's get 30 seconds on the group. And then I can go all in because I want to have some sort of reserve that if we get caught, that I'm not going to just be off the back. Right? But so where do you have that line of, okay, I'm 100% in this break. And if it gets, either we're going to win, we're going to succeed, we're going to break away, or when we get caught, I'll be so gassed that I won't be able to stay on.
I mean, you want to, the etiquette of the break is everyone works, you know, just as hard as the next guy, or you don't work harder than that next guy. So if you're just, you know, hanging on, hoping that something happens, well, you know, they might try to brush you off and like he said, drop you off because you're not contributing. Whether or not when we start rolling off the front that you can contribute or you do, you're not contributing now to the, you know, to the point that it's going to be successful or not. And so once one person, you know, slows down or is not contributing, you know, that's the sign of the breakaway coming down.
Yeah. And you're right. And maybe if I had helped out a little bit more, we could have maybe not missed that beat or, I mean, it's come down. I've seen breaks come down to where you're within two bike lengths of closing it down. And it just doesn't fully get closed down. And then it goes back out again. Right. So, you know, you never know what small little margin will allow a breakaway to be successful. And I possibly could have been the catalyst to not make this successful. But again, it had two cliff bars and two Coretechs in it that sometimes can be disastrous because everyone's not going to work like me. If it was Coretechs, cliff and mustache man, I'm giving everything I have. But since there is teammates, right? I mean, I don't know. Maybe I'm not going 100% on it. But tell me about, what is Mustache Man's name?
Chris Baker.
Chris Baker. Chris Baker. how impossibly strong is he?
Yeah, he's always in the right moves. He's a very patient, educated. He's got a good history, you know, ex-pro racer. He knows how, he's a pretty reliable wheel.
For sure. That guy is, yeah. So not only is he super strong, but he rides so smart. So he uses his unbelievable match at the most pristine time. So then we get caught here. And I think we're all sort of like, shit, really? You know, like, how did we get caught? Because we were drilling.
Yeah, that's just how this race was playing out. Nothing was sticking, and everyone was motivated. Once that break just starts to get established, and they slow it down, and, you know, and then guys just
after start a break chasing after hard. A break fails, what do you do?
Well, it depends on if I had a teammate or in it, or if I was in it or not. You know, so.
But so right here, I went to the very back because I don't have a teammate. I was going pretty hard because it wasn't just that. Like, I was on the front and I had been going with moves for like maybe 5 laps in a row because I felt like a move was going to go. But now I'm roasted, dude. And so the best I can do pretty much right now is hang on. And the field is going so fast and strung out so hard that moving back up to the front to try to like play in those moves again is just going to take more energy than I have. But so where are you at this moment? I mean, after that break failed, did you then go back off the front? Because you're going to be on the front and I'm on the back, so we're not going to see you really anymore. But you end up getting into a move with Chaz?
Yeah. I tried to play the front end of this race quite a bit more just to be present and active in those moves. So I was really just hanging on towards the end of this. We had the gas on pretty much the whole time, and it was a really fast race.
So, I don't know, because we're what, about 50, what does my Garmin say, 50 minutes? 50 minutes into an hour race, so 10 minutes left in the race. How long do you remember what your break was like? Because it was, your break was a done deal. I mean, it had a cliff in it, right?
Mm-hmm.
It had a Coretechs. It had Chaz, who chased me down. Asshole. And
I think Chaz everyone had the most energy, and he kind of initiated the move. And when I see Chaz moving that fast at the end of a race, I know that he is going to work hard to stay away, and he can roll away, and that he can stay away. So when I saw him doing that, I'm as motivated as the next to get up there with him and play my part, you know, coming towards the end of this race. If you're getting in that breaks, those moves, I mean, again, it's about being represented, but it's also, you know, thinking about, you know, the end of the race too, and you know, being present at that last moment. And so
now let's walk through. You have a good amount of team, you have sprinters, so you know that if it comes down to a sprint, you've got someone there. So you're trying to, because you can give everything you have and don't necessarily need to finish the race. Like, your end of the race doesn't have to be necessarily the actual finish. Because if you're pushing yourself on the front and you're destroying yourself, everyone's chasing, it's helping out your sprinter and your lead out guy not have to make those moves. But so let's talk about this crazy situation that happened here. Everyone starts to kind of slow down. Everyone's pretty tired. It has been full gas for 50 minutes, for sure. You now, it doesn't look like you've made the break yet, because I can see you there in the middle of the group, right?
And I'm definitely trying to save something for the end. I'm not, you know, so focused on that. I know that everyone's tired, and I know that where I am, I'm going to conserve the most I can for the last wee bit of the race. So I'm trying to just stay up, stay focused, and you know, just be active as much as I can in the race. But I'm not looking for moves to go so much, because I know everyone's tired. But if something was to be made, I can see it. And I can do the best I can, you know.
What did you eat for this race? I think it was late, like 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock.
It was, yeah.
So what did you eat leading up to this?
You know, I don't remember exactly what I eat, but usually something with that's an hour long like this. My breakfast routine is pretty normal. I'll eat when I wake up, and then going later in the day, I stay hydrated. I love my fluids and stuff. And so, you know, an hour or two before this, I'm not really eating very much. I've kind of gotten the most that I can, and I know that I got a, you know, an hour's worth of a race ahead of me, but I'm not doing anything special. I mean, I'm eating some fruit before it, you know, and...
How plant-based are you?
I'd say 99%, I guess.
What do you think about the trend of elite cyclists going plant-based or vegan?
You know, I think that everyone's going to make a choice and they're going to do what they want to, and they all have their own reasoning for it. But I think what sticks out the most is what other people think about the next person that's doing it. And so, you know, everyone's going to make their own choice. And when someone doesn't do something right, you know, and especially in a sport that you see a lot more loses than you do wins, you know, someone's always going to have something to say or critique. So unless you're doing something right every time, you know, people think a certain way about eating, you know, plant-based or however they eat, you know. But ultimately, it just comes down to how do you want to, you know, what do you want to put in your body, and what do you expect?
So let's talk about two more things, and then that will probably be once you've made what should have been the winning break. One, what cleat setting do you use for your shoes? Like, do you have a zero float? Do you have a little bit of float? You know, like Mark Cavendish says, zero movement in any of his shoe cleat pedal. Do you have anything that you have set?
I mean, I use Shimano cleats. I'm running, you know, Shimano setup. So yeah, I've been using that, the yellow cleats with just a little bit of float.
Dude, look how strung out this freaking race. Like, my legs are hurting just watching this thing. This is insanity. How I can't. I remembered it being hard, but when you look back and you see it just strung out for freaking an hour. Like, that's just nutso.
And like I said, the opportunity to do what you want is you know, is open here. You can use up a whole bunch of energy at all the wrong times. And I think everyone's just feeling it.
So give me the biggest difference between a P-1-2 crit and like a Cat-5 crit.
Well, usually everyone's, you know, tight. They're holding their wheels really well. In a Cat-5, it can be really strung out, but maybe the pace isn't as fast. I think that it's a lot easier to, you know, to make breakaways or whatever, because the pack is not so tight. But also, I've noticed in the P12s, the reason is it's so much faster is because pushing the boundaries of the course and the corners, and that's kind of some are a lot better than or more risky than others. I think that it's a whole lot faster, and you can count on the next guy's experience to ride tight in a pack, and if you bump shoulders with one guy, that, you know, it's on him of what's going to happen, but there's going to be some bumping of shoulders, and it's kind of the game that's played in these fast-paced crits. And I don't know if there's as much contact with a Cat-5 or a Cat-4 race.
Now, this guy in the Mike Spikes kit, so light blue, just to the right, white helmet, he won the race. And he did nothing the entire race. I mean, he sat on the back. He didn't go with any moves. Is that the move? Is that what you should do if you go solo and you have no team? Should you just... Because I want to look for every breakaway possible, because I'm not like a sprinter. So I think that if I sat on the back and waited at the finish, okay, cool. What am I going to do? Like, get top 15, maybe, best. But that guy didn't do anything. He just hung in. So I think almost everyone in this race had tried to make a move or bridged a move or went off the front, except for that guy. And he won the race. So, like, what does that say about just sitting in and being patient? And I think that maybe an amateur cyclist or someone that just started cycling would look at it and go, why don't you just sit in to the very end? Like that guy did. But so what is the advantage and disadvantage to playing that like end game? Doing nothing, waiting to the last turn.
I mean, a lot of the things we've already said, he is playing, he has a high risk of crashing, being at the tail end and riding the back. So if something crashes, he's gonna be behind it. So he's definitely taking a risk, you know, but also, like we said, with road racing is what it's about, patience and saving your energy. And so, you know, that's all those things are kind of the name of the game in the sport is you take risks and you read the race and you save your energy, and that's exactly what he did. And so it worked for him based on how the race played out. You know, if there would have been a breakup ahead, you know, he probably thought it's over, but you know, he's hanging on for that last second to grit his teeth for the last bit of the race and hopefully have more than the next guy.
All right, so we're at the tail end of this, right? We're at 59 minutes. Was this a 75-minute race? No, right?
Isn't it? It was about an hour race.
I felt like it was an hour, but my thing says 59 minutes, and so we still have about 10 minutes left to go in this race.
Was it 75 minutes?
I guess so. Ugh. 75-minute right? race.
And you can see everyone's really feeling it. I mean, we're just slogging away. Those moves aren't as active. And, you know, we're single filed. Everyone's just looking for a wheel. Everyone's feeling it.
So you get into a move with Chaz, and that seems to be... Tell me about... Because you've been sitting in the middle of the pack. You've gone with some moves. What... Like, walk me through that. It's how many laps? Like, 5 laps to go? And you got in a move with all the strong guys? Like, tell me about, like, walk me through it.
I mean, just based on how guys are riding here, if there's a move to be made off the front, knowing the attacks that have been made, you know, you can be pretty sure that breakaway is either going to stick or it's not. So getting into that breakaway, I was giving it everything I had, and everyone in that breakaway was working together evenly. We all knew that was the break. I think it was 3 guys at first, and then it was 4. I think one other guy came up, and it was a for sure podium for me. I mean, I just knew it was a podium.
Well, because there was only 3 guys, right?
Right, but I still wasn't happy. I really wanted the win, so I'm not settling. And that's just kind of how it goes. You get in that move, and you're like, okay, well, here's a podium. Or maybe the guys behind you are like, well, that's the winning move. But you're never happy until it's over. So that fight is just, you know, always conducive to the next lap and the games that are being played and you know, how everyone's working together. So yeah, to get in that move, I knew everyone was tired. I knew the guys in the moves were super strong and super motivated, and I was matching their efforts.
But so you get in that move, you played the game right. And I say game because it legitimately is like a game. You played your cards right. You did your duties, and you are now with a really strong guy, Chaz. You're with the bigger team, Cliff, and you have the other big team. 2 big teams, strong guy, great makeup. Game over. That should have worked. Everyone's super tired. No one's going to be chasing you. And yet, the 2 teams that should have been doing 0 chasing got on the front and chased you guys back. Because it wasn't just Coretechs chasing you back. Cliff was also rotating in through that and having guys on the front, and maybe they weren't going 100%, maybe they weren't drilling it, but they were on the front and not going easy. And but your team, Coretechs, was like full gas trying to chase you back because they, what? I mean, why were they thinking that that breakaway was not a good matchup when they had a guaranteed third?
I mean, I was in the front. I really didn't see it. I don't know. But I would think that, you know, that scenario, they're saying that, you know, they're gonna use their sprinter as their win, and they're gonna chase up to the front to bring their sprinter up so he can take the win, as opposed to, you know, a third place.
Chaz is not a sprinter,
right?
So did they not know Chaz was? Like, that's what I don't understand. It was such a textbook. Everyone in this group should have just literally mushroomed up and started conversating, right? It really should have been, and I've been in that sort of thing. You know, side note, I just saw someone YouTube and say conversating is not a word. I don't know what else you would. I think it is. It sounds like a word. Right? Two people are conversating. Is that not a word?
I'm pretty sure we do that on like every ride.
I don't know. The two people up front were having a full conversation. You know, you play the game, you play what should happen, and sometimes, you know, what do they call it in poker? Like a bad beat or whatever, where you play what is supposed to happen, and statistically this is going to be the most probable outcome, and yet you're in a break with a non-sprinter. Who was the cliff bar guy that was with you?
I forget his
name. Was he a sprinter?
No.
But so, like, you definitely probably have second wrapped up, for sure. Possibly a very good chance at a win. And so even if your team's thinking we have a guaranteed win with Nick, you don't have a guaranteed win in a bunch sprint, especially with this type of course. This little last, you know, there's not a big long sprint. So, I mean, that's hard to play that, to say that you're going to be able to get your sprinter a win when you have a bunch of guys. But so, again, also, like, you can see right there, Cliff had, like, four or five guys on the front, right? I just don't understand what their thought was. Like, what is their, maybe everyone's thinking something else. Maybe Cliff is thinking, our guy's not going to win because you're going to win. And then Coretechs is thinking, well, you're not going to win because Cliff's going to win. So then they're both chasing down their own teams.
I mean, ultimately, I would think they'd be up there to keep the pace fast enough that others wouldn't try and chase.
But maybe going too fast is a thing. Like, what pace would you set at the front to deter people from coming around and trying to make those bridges?
Not attacking pace.
So single file is, okay. So for someone who might not understand this, let's break this out a little bit more because we're getting close to the last lap here. You don't want someone attacking in the last bit of a race. You don't want guys sprinting from the back to the front, making these surges. It makes it really unpredictable. It makes it really hard. And then you could, you know, a lot of crashes can happen. So what big teams will do, you see this in the tour all the time, they line up nine dudes on the front and just drill it. It makes the pace so fast that it deters anyone from making a breakaway. You're not gonna put your face in the wind at 30 miles an hour. It's just not gonna happen.
I would say in the last two laps or so, when you got a guy in the breakaway, your team's eventually not gonna be the first guys in the front. I mean,
but they could go to the front and set a false pace. Like they are chasing, but they're not going as fast as the breakaway.
They're making it hard for guys to pass, but they're also blocking at the same time. So,
which is looks like what they're doing, but they were going a little too fast.
Right.
I mean, they were keeping the gap within a manageable one effort close down. And I just don't, I guess maybe if Coretechs had not jumped them or came around them, because there's Nick, there's your sprinter right there. If you guys had not, the Coretechs guys had not capitalized off that or went around Cliff, Cliff, I guess, is doing maybe the right thing by keeping it strung out.
Right. I mean, it's tough. You would expect a team not to be able to read the race enough that they're not going too fast to the point where they actually chase you down.
But so let's talk about being hypoxic, because this is a thing that happens. When racing, crit racing, the analogy is it's NASCAR while playing chess. It is very intricate. There's a lot of moves going along. There's a lot of things that you have to think about. And when you get hypoxic, which is you don't really have much oxygen in your blood going to your brain because you've been pinned for 75 minutes, I think we've all done that. It's hard to start thinking about tactics. It's hard to start remembering what's going on, remembering who's off the front. So, I mean, maybe that could be a thing. But at this elite of a level, you should have probably figured that out, right? You probably should have, in count 5, 4, 3, that's where you learn how to manage tactics, even in a hypoxic state, yeah?
Yeah, I mean, you would hope that you could count on your team to know the difference between chasing and blocking, or going too hard at the last second when you got a guy up the road. So, you know, it's disappointing how it played out.
So enough beating up on your team. What good things? What would you say is the single number one best thing about having a team versus not having a team?
Well, like I said, halfway through the race is kind of, when I'm just out there killing myself or whatever, that a teammate can kind of direct you and say, go, 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 or don't go, don't go. And we've gotten those words mixed up at times because they sound so close when you're just burying yourself. Sometimes all you hear is go, and you don't hear the don't go. You just hear go. But yeah, just being able to communicate and relying on the next guy to make a move. And you know, for me, it's helped out when a teammate had said go, go, go. And it made me go at a time that I might not have So yeah, it's always helped me get into a good move or it's always ended up well, playing out well, when we have more than others. And you know, over the course of the year, it just gets better. So the more time you can spend communicating and chatting with each other, that's going to be the best.
Now, did you guys get caught on the last lap?
Yes.
Because I think Rob had just pulled off from his unbelievable drill on the front to pull you back. And so you got caught on, because this is the last lap right here. Right? So I think I see you guys just up front. But it has been single file on the front chasing you guys for maybe 5 laps. And the people on the front were the teams who were represented in the back.
Right.
Right here,
kind of confusing.
Right here, you can see that one of those Chico Masters guys, he pulled off, he created a gap, which in the last bit of the race, it is blistering fast. And at the back, their gaps are just keep opening up because the guys just keep dropping off and dropping off and dropping off. And so I was in a horrible position. I should have been way more up front because I'm almost going harder than the guys up front on the front of the race.
Because those gaps are opening
up. Those gaps are opening up. So I'm closing gaps, closing gaps, closing gaps.
Now look at them. They're just off the front, just drilling it. Like, the whole group
is
blown up. Yeah. And you see all you see is blue and red just attacking each other off the front.
Yeah.
That's so crazy. When I was up the road and I was for sure podium, I was for sure the effort that I put into this and then not getting it was, you know, it's always frustrating, but this one for sure stuck with me for a little bit. And you know, it's just that constant battle.
Yeah. So, okay, end of race, gnarly. Yeah, it was an hour and 15 minute race, I believe. What is your cool down right now? What do you do right after you've just bled out your butthole for 75 minutes.
You know, I'll take a spin or two around. I don't have a race the next day. I'm not too worried about cooling down. But yeah, I'll just spin around a time or two. Usually stay kitted up and conversate with a couple others, spin around for a little bit longer. You know, I'm not in a hurry to go anywhere, so I'm kind of chatting with others and breaking the race down and trying to figure it out. But I was a little bit more disappointed with others than this one, so I kind of was probably just trying to, you know, just figure out what just happened. So I didn't really want to chat with everyone as much as I normally would. But yeah, I'm definitely trying to break it down and figure out what I could have done better or when I did something wrong, you know, and you're just kind of constantly evaluating and learning. And that's why GoPro is really great too, because you can kind of follow it and, you know, it'll really speak for itself.
For sure. How can people find you on social media if they want to follow your journey at all?
I am pretty active on Instagram. My Instagram is DSCRIB3, kind of like, it's like describe. So yeah, I'm pretty active on there. I'm also on Strava, where I put up a lot of my rides too.
I wanted to
definitely check out the Instagram. I'll be there.
Okay. I wanted to bring up really quick the, this race was on Sunday, right?
Yeah, I believe so. Saturday was the road race. Sunday was the crit.
August? It wasn't August.
It was earlier in the, January.
We're trying to find the overall stats of this really quick. The team day, no, not Jan. What the heck, when was March? Had to be, right? There we go. That should have been the move. All right, so did I get a second overall on the T-Solar Classic? No, I did not. Fastest lap for me was 28.4 miles an hour. That last lap was 29.7 miles per hour for a minute and 34 seconds. Holy googly moogly. 29.7 miles an hour for a minute, 34 seconds. The, what's the overall stats? So, average speed says it's 25.5, but that, I guess it's about right. 25.5 with 31 miles, whatever that is in metric, I'll convert that. It says my max watts was 1,702 watts, but that was not. I think it glitched out because it rained the day before. So, whatever. Anyway, hope you guys enjoyed this. That was the Turlock Crit. You can see the full breakdown on my YouTube channel linked at the end. And, guys, thank you so much. Vegan Cyclist, yeah.